Hi, everybody. Welcome to another edition of The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Today, we're going to discuss the importance of drawing.
The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now, Vince is going to share his creative process with you.
If you saw some of my earlier shows, you know I started out doing graphic design type work in the advertising field, and I wanted to develop and become more of an illustrator. Eventually what happened that I evolved into having a fine art painting career where I sell prints and originals and take commissions and so on and so on. What happened in the early days was I started looking at famous historical artists, Rembrandt, Van Gogh, people like that, and I immediately saw that every one of them had sketchbooks. Every one of them drew. You'd see these fantastic paintings that a lot of us have seen through history, Michelangelo, whoever. But I saw that every one of them drew and had not only a sketchbook, but lots of them. So I went out and I found this the other day. This is actually my first sketchbook. And these are some of the drawings I was doing at that time. And as I try to tell people, I wasn't very good when I started and nobody really believes me. Now I have physical proof. This is the type of stuff I did in year one of trying to transform my life into an art career. I had some rudimentary color, markers, pencils, and I just started drawing. I saw that these famous people had sketchbooks, so I figured I'll go get one and I'll start drawing. And this was the type of stuff that I was doing. But you get my point. I started drawing. I had not drawn in 3 years. And then I went from that to drawing virtually every day for the next 30 years. And that's how I developed. That's why drawing is so important. One of the things I want to discuss is why drawing is so important. It's the development of your visual idea. That's what all that drawing is about, the sketchbook stuff. You look at real things in real life. They're three-dimensional, and your challenge is to put it on a two-dimensional surface and make it appear three-dimensional. That's not easy. That's why all of us start out copying photographs, which is fine, but the photo is already on a two-dimensional surface, and you're working on a two-dimensional surface. With a lot of practice, it's really not that difficult to do after a while. But when you start working from life and drawing from real objects in front of you, whether it's a cityscape, a model, or a piece of fruit, that's a three-dimensional object that you're transferring to a two-dimensional form to trick the eye into looking like it was three dimensions. And all that stuff gets stored in your mind. It's like a piano player practicing, and they develop his or her vocabulary more and more broadly by doing that. So that when they play and perform later, they have that whole reservoir to draw from. The painting you see on the screen is called Tesla and Westinghouse Power, the 1893 World's Fair. It was a commission I did. As you see, it's extremely complex. There's also a problem. There was no color photography in those days. This painting is an oil painting, and it's a composite of the fair. There were 200 and some buildings. The famous Ferris wheel made by Ferris from Pittsburgh was 270 feet in diameter. The axle, the piece of steel that was the axle, was the largest piece of steel ever forged at that time. Proud to say there were no accidents. The cars held 40 people, and so on and so on. So how do I reduce this down? All this stuff that was going on to show how Nikola Tesla and George Westinghouse powered this fair with alternating current. Nothing like this had ever been seen before. And as I said, there was no color photography. So I had to work out ideas. this was eventually the sketch that I became my main drawing for it. But even before that, I had this sketch done, and then every time I work it up larger, and this came from a handful of thumbnails, I was trying to figure out how to do this. In each stage, I would change things as I got larger and larger towards the size I was eventually going to work in. I can show, I'm not going to show you every one of this, but this is the pile of drawings that I did for the fair. Some of this isn't going to make much sense to other people. A lot of these scribbles are really notes to myself about visual ideas for the painting. Dark sky, how about the left side dominant with dark question mark? But don't lose what's happening with the balloon. In other words, it doesn't have to be to be symmetrical. Use this as an opportunity for action and movement. That gets, and you know, right below it is the balloon drawing for the painting. So what I'm trying to say is, when you look at a painting, you're looking at the last mark the artist made. And we did some shows on painting and composition and things. But behind that, much like when you look at a building and it's completed, you don't see the foundation anymore. You don't see the drafting blueprints. You don't even see the idea in the architect's mind, of course. You're looking at the finish. So when you draw, you're drawing on a napkin waiting for your food in a diner. You see a salt shaker in front of you. You do a drawing from it. That's all practice. That's all training your brain to see things visually and in three dimensions. And as you learn more about composition, which we discussed in other shows, it all just develops. This is why drawing is so important and so critical. Architects, interior designers, you would be amazed if you talked to certain professionals in certain fields that you don't think of as artists, but so many of them can draw. They may not draw as well as somebody who's making a living from drawing and painting, but they all learned about the importance of the visual language. And it's fun, actually, too, because there's a sense of freedom that comes with drawing that may not come with other parts of the development of a painting or sculpture or something like that. As I said, when I was starting out, I really didn't go to art school. I went to night school for 9 months for graphic design type of stuff. I didn't really study for, you know, 2-3 straight years or anything like that. I went to night school for 9 months for graphic design and advertising type stuff. And afterwards, I started taking workshops here and there, anywhere I saw somebody whose artwork was good and they were giving a one-day or one-afternoon workshop, I would jump on. And eventually, I was studying with Daniel Green up in New York. But in that early period, I saw that all these great historical artists all drew and had sketchbooks. People like Rembrandt, people like Vincent van Gogh, Andy Warhol, who I don't consider him myself a great artist, great painter, but he was very good at being Andy Warhol, but he was a really tremendous graphic designer. And, you know, you could see his creativity in his drawings. Leonardo da Vinci, of course, was one of the great geniuses of all time in a variety of fields, and he sketched out everything. One of the things you have to keep in mind, when you go back in time, there's no photography, there's no radio, there's no anything that we take for granted today. So visually, they had to look at objects and render objects. Even back in the cave drawings, whoever those people were looked at animals and did drawings of them, and they saw that they actually started using the contour of the cave for part of the depiction. I saw something, a man, I didn't even know there was such a thing, but he's an acoustic historian, and they started figuring out that in these caves where the acoustics are the best, there were more drawings there, and they wondered if it was a type of performance art. Here is Michelangelo, the Libyan Sibyl that is part of the Sistine Chapel. Even Jackson Pollock, where people think he just threw paint against the canvas, that's not what he was really doing. That's a big subject we can talk about some other time. But he drew also. Here is Edward Hopper, his famous Nighthawks painting, and you can see the drawing before that. And he did dozens and dozens and dozens of sketches to work out that idea. This is my teacher, Daniel Green. That's actually his father-in-law in one of his Subway paintings. And of course, Dan, much like myself, he I didn't drop out of high school, but Dan did, and he worked as a sketch artist for a couple years and saved money so he could start out in New York and study at the Art Students League. Again, it's that work ethic that we've talked about before. This is interesting. This is Edward Hopper and Hitchcock, Alfred Hitchcock. He saw Edward Hopper's House by the Railroad painting, and he admitted that that was the inspiration for the house in Psycho. And I also included here some of the storyboards for Alfred Hitchcock's famous movie, The Birds. We talked about my first sketchbook. This is, the idea is to just keep, this is the stuff. Musicians are alone in their room practicing their guitar. They're practicing their piano. Singers are practicing what they can do with their voice. But you don't see them doing that. With artists, we put it down on paper, and you can see, quote-unquote, our practice and our working out of ideas, and that's what all this drawing is about. One of the things I want to mention is, as I said, all the historical artists that I admired and enjoy looking at their work, every one of them drew. Every one of them has sketchbooks. This is a book Norman Rockwell put together called Rockwell on Rockwell, and it's how I make a picture. And he goes through the procedure of what he does to develop his visual ideas. This chapter on getting the picture idea, look, more drawing, of course. You know, he goes from the drawings on your left to the finished painting. He had to work it out first and figure out what he was doing. This is very interesting. He starts every painting with a lamppost. He says something about it. It just gets him thinking. He puts a lamppost, made him think of a drunken sailor. The sailor made him think of a sailor sewing his own torn pants or something. The sewing made him think of a woman sewing, and on and on and on. But for some reason, it's a trigger for him. That's just something he does. But who would think that when you look at these drawings, that those great finished paintings of Norman Rockwell started with that? Here are some others. The great illustrator, Frank Frazetta. This book's rough work. It has a lot of his drawings in it. Again, you're back to drawing, developing the idea, adding in some color. Now he's going to be doing an oil painting. And he got so skilled. I saw his originals at his museum, that his efficiency in painting was just, I'm green with envy. Sometimes I paint too slowly on the more labored studio pieces. obviously, Andrew Wyeth. This book is Wyeth at Kerner's Farm, which was a farm where he did a ton of paintings from, that was a neighbor of his. draw, draw, draw. I hope I'm getting across the point of how important drawing is. Think of it like this way. If it's in color, it's a painting. Pastel painting. If it's in color, it's a painting. If it's in black and white, it's a drawing. You can draw with oil paint. You know, a black and gray, you're drawing. You know, when it's almost like when you're painting, you're drawing with color. That's the way to think of some of this stuff. This piece here, you can see it came right from the charcoal drawing. And I hope that's making more and more sense to you. This is a Disney book. And again, you see on the top the drawing, on the bottom the finished cartoon from 1932. And boy, there was a lot to be said for a lot of those cartoonists in those days. And I hope this is making more and more sense. But the connection between the mind and the drawing, and then the drawing and the painting, is a straight line to it. The line, it doesn't always go so straight, but there's a direct connection is what I'm really trying to say. I I just want to talk a little bit about this painting that I'm working on. It's part of a triptych. It's three paintings together, Joan of Arc, St. Francis of Assisi, and Father O'Flaherty. He was a Vatican priest that during the occupation of Rome, he hid out about 6,000 people right under the Germans' nose, mostly Jewish people and people who had escaped from prisoner of war camps right under the Gestapo's nose. But I wanted to do this painting of the three of them together. It's an amazing story. The reason I'm mentioning all that, I happen to be working on this. I really don't like to show stuff before I kind of release it to the public, but that's okay. Anyway, notice in here, you can see, this is unfinished, some of the drawing lines. You could see the grid I did, and I do use grid. Rembrandt's used grids. Everybody used grids. But working with them isn't as easy as people think. That's a whole other discussion. Just because you gridded something out doesn't mean, oh, wow, it's easy now. That's a whole other discussion. It's hard to get from point A to point B accurately no matter what. But I just wanted to show you this because I'm working on it, and hopefully you can see a little bit of the drawing part of it, and then the color came in later. Now, that is this one that I'm currently on. The Joan of Arc piece is basically finished, although I always go back at the end and stare at it until I can't take it anymore to figure out some other way to improve it. I'm always looking to improve. So, again, you just saw one in progress. This one is basically finished. I will make a few adjustments. I know I will. But just to give you an idea, you cannot see the drawing anymore, the physical drawing itself, the charcoal that I drew with. You can, it's okay to use charcoal for oil painting. Excuse me, don't use graphite. They fight against each other chemically. Use charcoal if you want to draw and then do oil paint, and use the workable fixative, and it is a workable fixative, spraying over the charcoal when you're done with that. Start on the outside, start it, spray it across, then let it go. Don't start right on the painting with any type of fixative or anything like that. But I just wanted to show you, again, you can't see the drawing at this point, but it's there, it's under there, much like the foundation of a building. What I'm going to attempt to do here, this is a little tricky because I got to kind of stand off center that I'm used to and so on, but I'm just looking at something which to your eye will be over my shoulder. It's my television over there in the studio, the cabinet that it's sitting on, which is below the television, and to the left of it is a lamp, a light, the bulb facing away from us, so you're seeing the back of the light. I'm just going to draw, and I'm doing it really to demonstrate. I'm not worrying about fine detail. I'm going to use marker so that it appears clearer on the television. This is a very thin Bic pencil that I'm starting with, and all I'm doing is I'm just sketching. Now, I know this is my format, all right, and I know the television would be to the right of my format. You may not be able to see this on the show right at the moment, but this was just a beginning, and I'm going to have a lighter marker here. Pretend this is a pencil, that I would have been doing this maybe more with a pencil. This is a good light marker. This should register on the TV screen, but I look at the TV and it is practically a square, but it's a bit more of a rectangle going horizontally. This is really dry. It's an old marker, so I'm going to get off of this pretty quick. But compositionally, how far away from the TV is this lamp? How high is it? These are the questions I'm asking myself. Where does the cabinet go? And when I divide up the drawers, I know drawers are going to be all the same size, which is a good thing. So I know there's four drawers. I would cut this into fours. There's some stuff sitting on top. That's actually paintings. I use a dish rack to put paintings in to dry. There's an old lunch bucket from like the 50s era that I acquired. in the deep background, there's the window. Again, I'm calling these windows, I'm calling them TVs and all, but to me, they're shapes. And this is practice. This is, and what happens, much like when a musician practices, if they're good, and you threw on the recorder, you can end up with some pretty good practice stuff. A lot of the songs that we know were done, and this is kind of, this is the TV, you know, that they list Sony, I'll just put it here. And there's some reflection in here. Okay, I'm doing this extremely rapidly. Pretend I was doing this entirely in pencil, okay? And I'm just laying out for my painting or drawing or pastel or whatever I'm doing. But these are all shapes. You know, from the side, the lunch bucket looks like a piece of toast or something. I do have the television sitting on a piece of masonite. That gave it a bigger base. The filing cabinet starts inside the television. And the other part of it goes here. Like I said, divided into fourths. There'd be one more down there. Rectangle, rectangle. And I'm drawing with my body. I'm not squeezing this marker. I'm drawing from the floor up. I'm using my body, my shoulder. This is a little magnet of Loretta Lynn, actually. This is the handles. And it's more like, where do these things go? This is some promotional material of mine in a box. It's not so much what it is. This is my caricature sign, chair. Okay, this chair is closer. I should have made it bigger. That's a mental note for myself. Now, when I first started out, I would have saw a chair, a television, a light, a window. And I wouldn't have seen it as a unit the way I see it now. And that comes from all these years of painting. This lamp, my initial gesture of the lamp is way too far over. It's actually closer to, and I'm trying to figure out the height, it's actually closer to the structure to our right. Okay. When you think of the drawings we looked at during the show, the famous artist, the not so famous like myself, this is behind all those paintings, what I'm doing now. I don't know how long, this is probably going to take 5 minutes to do or something like that. But as we say, 5 minutes in one lifetime. People ask me, how long does it take you to do a caricature when you're at parties? And it takes me 3 minutes in one lifetime. This isn't great art. This isn't meant to be anything other than what it is. But sometimes, if you have a good artist, there's often more art, more artistic stuff in something like this than a long labored painting that really doesn't say much. I'm going to interject some dark areas in here. If I was doing a painting later, like I'd know there'd be a shadow down here. You know, this signboard here would create a shadow here. Again, this may not look, there'd be a deep shadow to the side of the television. This may not look like much, or maybe it does. I hope it looks like something. There's shadows down in here on the chair. But you saw a lot of complex artwork during this show. And this is where you work out the complexity with the drawing. I'm trying to find shadow areas. There's a ton of cross light in a situation like this. Looking out the window across the street to my, this is my studio we're in, across the street to my neighbors. You know, there's windows across the street. So I talked about the powers of observation and be able to digest things at a glance. Now, the cabinet has a black color, and the temptation is to make it that way. Well, I'm not so concerned about that right now. This isn't a color drawing. Black is a color. It's actually an extremely deep gray, which we've talked about on another show. It's really not black. But so now let me frame it. And what I'm accomplishing here is tightening everything up. That's what frames do. They trap the eye. So I'm doing this. And this is the kind of sketching that those books, my old sketchbooks and current sketchbooks, are filled with, this type of thing. And I'm trying to figure out how to draw. I'm trying to figure out how do I make the next painting. Now, whether this was a model sitting in front of me, and I'm doing this with pastel. We have a show about portrait painting that I did. Whether these are thumbnails on my drawing table to figure out ideas. I said that Chicago World's Fair painting was very complex, and it was a lot of work. There's no color photography, as I said, and I had to work all these things out. Again, this isn't meant to be earth-shaking artwork, this particular demonstration. It's just meant to show you newsprint. It's the cheapest paper made. You could get a stack of newsprint for a few dollars and you have paper and you can just draw. You can draw on napkins in a restaurant. You draw on a friend of mine who's a humorous illustrator for American Greeting. He draws ideas on his hands when he's short. He always has a pen on him. He said the cat is a little afraid around him because he's liable to draw on the cat because these ideas are in his head and he doesn't have anything to scribble on. He got to put it somewhere. But since it's a visual language, you want to get it down visually. If you're a musician, I heard Stevie Wonder in an interview. He has a little recorder with him. He thinks of a melody. He gets it out on that recorder. And there's all kind of stories like this about creative people. Last story on that, Roger Miller, who wrote King of the Road, a lot of people know that song. He saw a little hobo kind of bobblehead thing in an antique store. And when he saw that, that triggered the idea. And he bought it. And in his hotel room later, and they have the placemat or whatever he scribbled the lyrics at King of the Road, he wrote it on. But if you're not involved in this stuff as a regular basis, it's harder and harder to start. And the secret is starting. I used to say there is no secret other than work, but there really is. The secret is starting. And the best place to start, beyond a doubt, is drawing. Finally, I like to do a book recommendation. I am a book person. I recommended this earlier in this creative process series. But this book, since the subject today was the importance of drawing, The Natural Way to Draw by Kaiman Nicolades, who is a famous instructor at the Art Students League in New York, was putting this together. Unfortunately, he had died before he finished it, but his students put it together. And it's like in its 35th printing or something like that. It's one of these books the general public doesn't know about, but people in the field do. It is a phenomenal book on drawing. He actually put together a one-year program for people who couldn't afford to go to art school or didn't have time and go through this process of learning how to draw. This is an excellent book for that. And once again, I thank you for watching The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. When I would do caricatures in malls years ago, when I didn't have any business, guess what I would do? I would practice and draw. That's where so much of this stuff comes from. And I've sold lots and lots of drawings that way, that it was, in my mind, a practice type thing. But notice the design and composition. This is the stuff we've talked about before. And again, these are all drawings that later on I pull from. They kind of get stored away in the mind, and they broaden my own visual vocabulary. all the drawing I just showed you is behind what I'm showing you right now. That's why drawing is so important.